Good morning. It's good to welcome you as we share in worship in this way together. My name is Major Mike Lloyd-Jones and I'm the Divisional Commander here in the Central South Division, and it's my humbling opportunity to share with you as we worship together and as we open God's Word and learn together something more of what it means to be followers of Christ in these days of ours. I'm going to read from the Bible. I'm going to read from Luke chapter 24. These are very familiar words, a familiar account that many of us will have heard of before, but there is the opportunity for a fresh insight, a fresh revelation from God himself as he speaks to you and me through the reading and consideration of his word. So Luke chapter 24, beginning to read at verse 13. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor in Jerusalem? Do you not know the things that have happened here in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to save Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women have amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but they didn't find his body. They came and told us that they'd seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of the companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them all that Scripture said concerning himself." As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going further, but they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening, the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. Amen. We'll consider those words a little bit later on this morning.
Beautiful one, I adore. Beautiful. life, cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you, Jesus. And you've opened my eyes to your wonders and new. You've captured my heart with this love.
Together. Beautiful one, wonderful, so wonderful. Lord God, we praise you, we worship you, we acknowledge your lordship today. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And when we look at Jesus, we see the very face of God. And we recognize our own need of you, our need for relationship with you. And so as we share together this morning, may we be aware of your very presence, a very living relationship with our living God, with us. As we consider the steps of life's journey, may you challenge us to reflect. And may, as we gather online in this way, our lives be impacted because we've been in your presence. We know you, our beautiful God. Bless us as we continue to journey in our shared act of worship this day. Amen.
To be in your presence, to sit at your feet, where your love surrounds me and makes me complete. This is my desire, O Lord. This is my desire. This is my desire. This is my desire. To rest in your presence, not rushing away, to cherish each moment, here I would stay. This is my desire, O Lord. This is my desire. This is my desire, O Lord. This is my desire. Thank you.
but time seems to be flying. It doesn't seem 2 minutes since it was Christmas and New Year, and then we had the lockdown where it seemed very dark and heavy days. Other events have just come and gone. We've had Mother's Day, we've had my birthday, we've had Easter, and here we are in the middle of April. And time seems to be flying. There's a lot of talk about roadmaps in these days. The government have given us a roadmap out of COVID-19 and the pandemic restrictions that are placed on us. And today we are considering a road, a journey on a road. The road to Emmaus. A familiar account, one which I'm sure you've heard of before and may have heard many times over. But it's worth considering again. It's an interesting account. We're only given one of the names of the two people who were already on their way to Emmaus when Jesus caught them up. They were walking together home from Jerusalem, where they'd seen so many things happen. We know Cleopas is one of them. Perhaps it was a husband and wife, or perhaps it was friends. We don't know. It seems almost impossible. It seems as though they had their eyes closed, that two of Jesus' close followers could bump into him on a road between Jerusalem and Emmaus and not even realise who he was. Even when he explained the scriptures of the Old Testament, when he unpacked the prophets and pointed at all they said about the Messiah, a saviour for the whole world, it didn't ring a bell in their mind, and they didn't grasp that he was talking about himself. If we give them the benefit of the doubt, and I like to give the benefit of the doubt, it does say in the Bible that they were prevented from recognising him until that crucial moment when he broke bread and shared. In that moment, their eyes were unveiled. They saw who he was and they knew who he was. This was Jesus. And he disappeared from their sight. How frustrating. It really would be a massive frustration for them that he disappeared straight away. He went away straight away before they were able to ask any questions, gain any more insight. Maybe Jesus kept them from recognizing him earlier because he really wanted them to know how he was the one prophesied in the Old Testament by those prophets, and that he was coming in a different way to perhaps the way that they anticipated as a military ruler. And if he identified too early, then they would have been too excited to listen properly and fully understand. Maybe that's why he disappeared when they did recognize, so they could stop and reflect and concentrate on thinking about his teaching rather than the 101 questions they would have been bound to ask. Perhaps that's just a theory, but if there's any truth in it, maybe that should be an encouragement to us, to you, to me, to keep on learning, to look again at what is familiar in this post-Easter period, looking at what the Bible tells us, sharing and teaching, sharing, being together, even though we do it on the internet. Our prayer must be that the Holy Spirit will reveal the identity of Jesus for you and for me, so that we worship him in spirit and in truth.
Thank you.
here we are. Easter has come and gone, and a week or two after Easter, we share in this way and we continue to consider and reflect upon the impact that that Easter had. When I was a little kid, Christmas was a massive thing. I was so excited for Christmas. The build-up, the anticipation, I could never wait for Christmas to come soon enough. As I've got a bit older, and sadly grown up a little bit, I've matured and my excitement has shifted. I love Christmas and all that happens, but actually Easter has become more and more important, more and more integral in my life and in my understanding as a follower of Jesus. It's been a difficult couple of years as we've not been able to share in celebrating on Easter morning in the usual way, but there has still been that journey towards Easter. This year, the officers in Central South Division were issued a book at home in Lent, and it gave us a thought each day to stop and reflect as we journeyed towards the Easter events. Time to spend in contemplation, in reflection throughout Lent. And then we moved to Good Friday. I love Good Friday. I always found it very strange as a youngster. Why is it good? But actually we see sin broken and vanquished and beaten on Good Friday, which makes it absolutely a good day. There's Low Saturday, that day in between Good Friday and Easter Day, where we're never quite sure how we feel. And then there's Easter Day itself, a time of celebration. But when I was a youngster, Christmas would come and go, and I would sense a down, a flop, a letting down of the emotion and excitement. And there is a danger, there is a risk of that with Easter, that actually we get through the celebration of Jesus risen. He is risen indeed. 3 days later, he rose up from the grave. And then what? Well, there was a lot happen in the next few days, the next few weeks after Easter. The Bible records 10 different resurrection appearances of Jesus. I have mentioned in times past that over 500 people saw Jesus and gave testimony. Now, if we gave them 15 minutes each, it would take 128 hours to listen to that testimony that they saw the risen Jesus. Today, we're considering for a few moments one of the most captivating of those accounts. A story only found in the Gospel of Luke. And the setting is a hike between Jerusalem, where all these events had taken place, and Emmaus, where it's presumed this couple, possibly a man and a wife, Cleopas and somebody else, were journeying. We're not sure about those specific details. There's lots of things we're not sure of. Scholars are not sure exactly where Emmaus is in modern times. Luke tells us it's about a 7-mile walk, so it gives us some idea. And the two travellers were probably surrounded by other people who were progressing along the journey and the route. Pilgrims making their way to their homes. How did they feel? Well, we can only guess. And we guess that their emotions were all over the place. There would have been fear. Things had happened that made them anxious. Perhaps there's that tiny bit of hope we hoped after 3 days. Incredulity. Can this really have happened? And even perhaps disappointment. And basically, we can go on the same emotional roller coaster ride that they did. Perhaps after the high of Easter, we grow a little bit despondent and disappointed. But here's a story of disappointment turning to joy. Cleopas and his companion had put their hope in Jesus as their nation's saviour. Now, the Bible says that they were walking and they were downcast. Literally, they cast their faces down. They would have been looking at the feet and the journey, the next step ahead, as they shared. We had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. They were tired of living under the tyranny of Roman government and desperately wanted God to rescue them. And Jesus looked like he was the answer to that prayer. And yet, it appeared that their hopes died on a cross. I don't know about you, I'm fed up. I'm tired of COVID and the restrictions that it's placed on us, the challenges it brings to day-to-day life. And if I'm not careful, I could become downcast. And yet, just as for Cleopas and his acquaintance, they found that Jesus was the answer. He was the answer to their prayer. So it can be for us, even in these COVID days. The two continued, recollecting what they'd been told. The women had been to the grave and they found it empty. His body wasn't where it was supposed to be. They were confused. In their sadness, in their disappointment, perhaps a little hopeful, but they were afraid to be hopeful. Perhaps they even were angry with God for dashing their hopes, for not answering their prayers. And I think, if I'm honest, and if you're being honest, we can relate. Sometimes it seems as though we are let down, as though God doesn't come through for us in the way we expect. We pray for healing and it doesn't happen. We talk to God about a relationship and it gets worse. We pray for peace of mind and we become more uneasy. We pray for enough money to get through the month, but the cash ends before the bills. We pray for strength and for fellowship and relationship in a time of COVID, and it doesn't happen. Sometimes it takes us a while to remember that God is still there, that the Lord is still there, and that the Lord can handle our anger and our disappointment and our sadness. There were two people on this journey and they were enjoying a pity party. They were reveling in disappointment. And sometimes in our pity party, in my pity party, what we really need, to be honest, is a heavenly kick to get us going. We need Jesus. We need to hear Jesus say to me, "Mike, how foolish you are, how slow to believe." And in these days, as we begin to lift our head from being downcast as a Salvation Army, from being downcast as meeting in fellowship together, from being downcast as individual believers, we lift our head. And perhaps we need to hear those words, "How foolish you are, how slow to believe." And we begin the second phase of a journey on this Emmaus road. And here we see the clarification of God's will through scripture. That's what Jesus did. He unpicked the Old Testament, the prophecies about the Messiah, and how it wasn't predicted not only a triumphant Messiah, but one who would suffer and die and rise again. We don't know what verses he would use. Maybe he started in Genesis 3, where the original story of sin was unveiled and ran through. Perhaps he picked up on the lines about Adam and Eve and a descendant who would break the head of the serpent for good. Maybe he quoted from Isaiah 53, familiar words very often on a Good Friday, about the suffering servant. Or Zechariah 12, verse 10, the one pierced for our transgressions. Or Malachi 3, verse 1, the messenger of the covenant. You see, those first Christians needed a larger picture of their Messiah. They needed to understand that as the Messiah came to suffer, at times we all suffer. But the Messiah came and overcame victorious, and we will as well, if we trust in God's will and God's ultimate redemption plan. The early church needed to understand that God's kingdom comes not through earthly governments, but through one human heart at a time, making a difference one person at a time. And perhaps for you and I in these weeks after Easter, as we begin to lift our heads and look to a post-COVID time, that we finally allow the Holy Spirit to speak through Scripture, and that God will bring the adjustments that you and I need. We don't ask God to come round to our understanding, because God is God and we are not God. God broadens our perspective. He helps us see the bigger picture, and we move to the third stage of the journey here to Emmaus. We grow joyful. The two disciples, 7 slow, long, heavy, sad miles home. Then Jesus unexpectedly took on the role as host and broke the bread for them, and God opened their eyes. They were filled with joy. We're not sure why everything clicked in this one moment. Perhaps the sequence of bless, break, and share reminded them of the stories of the Last Supper with his disciples, or the breaking of the bread with fish and the feeding of the 5,000. Perhaps God had given them a time when they would believe without seeing before they opened their eyes to Jesus. We don't know. But they recalled it was different. As they reflected, they said, weren't our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the 7-mile journey? And then they went back to Jerusalem. And I would put money on it if I was a betting man, and I'm not, so you don't need to report me. But actually, there was no doubt they did it at a faster pace this time. Christ had risen, they'd met him, they knew it, and they were rushing back, and their faith was still very much alive. Hope had been reborn in their hearts. They found Jesus on their journey, and when they arrived back at Jerusalem, they discovered that Peter had seen him as well, and all the doubts would have been cast aside. Jesus is alive. It's echoed not just on Easter Sunday morning, but here in the lives of two people who were on a journey. And it can be echoed in our lives, on our life journey too. Everything was different. Revelation 21 verse 5 says that Jesus makes all things new. You would think that we can learn a lesson or two from these two on the road to Emmaus, when COVID seems to be a burden, when we mourn, when we sense a loss of all that we know, when the money runs out, when a prognosis hits hard, when arthritis flares up, when jobs bring challenge or unemployment faces its day, when a person rubs us up the wrong way, maybe we can cause and pause to reflect. Maybe we could search for Jesus on the journey. When we catch ourselves growing discouraged, maybe we could purposefully set ourselves on a collision course with God himself. When God speaks through his word, everything changes. These are familiar words, a familiar account. But there were two lives irrevocably changed by meeting with the risen Jesus on a journey. And the best thing is, for you, for me, in our life's journey, Jesus comes alongside and gives us the opportunity to share in his joy and know the fullness of walking with him in our day to day.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song. Whatever may worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
take these moments to come into the very presence of God. Let's pray. Lord God, we in this day stop. And wherever our life's journeys are taking us, we take moments to reflect. We thank you for this illustration that is written down in the Bible, that is passed through history and speaks to us in our day, in our age. The story of Cleopas and his acquaintance, whoever that may be, how they were downcast and burdened with life's journeys and the steps that they were taking. And they journeyed a long 7-mile hard path. But then they met the risen Jesus and it changed their lives. They rushed back with joy, transformed and celebrating the risen Jesus. And Lord God, for us, wherever we are, separated by COVID restrictions, maybe downcast in our journey, in our fellowship together, may we encounter the risen Jesus and may we be changed. I pray for all those who watch this teaching, this time of shared worship together, I pray that they may know the transforming power of Jesus, the transforming power of Jesus' Spirit, the Holy Spirit, in and on us. So that as a Salvation Army here in Central South and beyond, we will be transformed by celebrating the risen Jesus. Bless us, I pray, in Jesus' name. A final blessing, a final benediction together. This is the God we adore, our faithful, unchangeable friend, whose love is as great as his power, which knows neither measure nor end. It's Jesus, the first and the last, whose Spirit shall guide us safe home. We'll praise him for all that is past. And Lord, we're going to trust you for all that's to come. Amen. May God continue to bless and challenge us as we journey through life's path together.
The whole